Well, good afternoon and welcome to Highland Baptist Church, to the worship of God and celebration for the life of David Nakdimen. Whether you are here with us in this space or joining us virtually on behalf of Dave's family, I want to thank you for being part of this time together today. Wanda and Suzanne are grateful to have with us many of Dave's former colleagues from the Wave 3 Network, beloved friends from here at Highland, members of our Louisville community, and they are especially grateful for Dave's family who traveled from across the country to be here with them today. I am mindful that we have lost so much throughout the pandemic, because when we weren't able to gather face to face, suddenly we lost so many of the rituals that we practiced together as a community. Rituals like this one. Rituals are important because they mark moments as significant. They claim a physical time and space for us to be held by one another and to be held in the arms of God. Wanda and Suzanne and their family have gone well over a year now without Dave and without this ritual to honor his life with the people he loved. But I believe that makes today all the more sacred as we are finally able to pay tribute to Dave Nakdimen's life here in this space that was so important to him and so central to the life he lived. I did not have the privilege of knowing Dave Nakdimen, but upon moving to Louisville this past year, it didn't take me long to discover that he was a pillar, not only in this congregation, but also in this community. When I asked some of his closest friends in his Bible study class here at Highland to describe Dave to me, they immediately began to tell me how Dave was a man of integrity. He was wise, genuine, a true friend. They shared about how Dave was always objective and insightful. He was faithful, and he was kind. And so today, as we remember David Nakdimen, we will mark this moment as sacred. We bring all of our grief, our memories, our tears, and our hopes to one another in this space and to the God who meets us here. Let us worship God together. Please join me in our opening words from Scripture. God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you. Not as the world gives, do I give to you. Let not your hearts be troubled, neither let them be afraid. As a father loves his children, so the Lord draws near to all people who mourn. As a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you. The eternal God is your dwelling place, and underneath are the everlasting arms.
There is no shadow. Let's pray together. Gracious and loving God, show us this day how Dave's life, so well lived in service and love for you, will help us renew our desires to do as well in your honor. Help us feel your presence and blessing today in the stories and the music. In the name of the Christ, amen. Wanda has asked me to say a few words, and so I'll try to make it brief. There's some sadness today, but I am so glad that we get to celebrate our friend Dave Nakdimen. Rosemary and I have been friends with Dave and Wanda 57 years. Wanda, 64 years. And Suzanne, well, since birth. Many good times, many, many good times, happy times, very special times. So let me just share a few of these memories and thoughts. As close family friends, I think we helped each other, Rosemary and I, and Wanda and Dave, rearing Suzanne and our kids, Joel and Jennifer. I recall Dave and I comparing notes on teenagers. Like the time, Joel and Suzanne went off to some grungy thrift store. As parents, we tried to give our kids nice clothes. They chose a thrift store. Joel came home with an old faded raincoat like the one TV detective Columbo wore. And Suzanne, a ragged chenille robe. Well, friend Dave said, "Jim, it's okay. They'll outgrow it." We were always proud of our kids. But Dave was never one to be a bragging until Angela came along. And many times at our breakfast gatherings, the first thing we talked about was our grandkids. To me, Dave's knowledge, photographic memory, people skills, and his near passion for music, theater, sports, politics, and the government gave him a kind of Renaissance persona to me. But he would never describe himself as such. I invite you to Google Wave TV and Dave Nakdimen and look at that kind of a biography, not only of his journalism, but what he did in the community and elsewhere. Dave had a quiet, effective way for doing good things for others. We knew we could trust him with important things. For example, here in his church, he carefully guided a bunch of nervous church leaders to approve the first woman deacon, a very, very progressive action at the time. Dave didn't complain about needed change. He quietly did the change. Dave had a collector's dream library of old movies, CDs, and classical music with everything from Beethoven to John Wayne. He quoted lines from movies and easily imitated John Wayne's swagger, you know. Just a minute there, Pilgrim. Gosh, we shared many a breakfast together in these one-on-one times. live in my mind and heart. For quite a long time, Dave skipped Sunday school here. You see, he and my father-in-law, Louis Bache, would huddle on Sunday mornings back in the very back of the church and held what Dave called our own Sunday school. We discussed deep theological truths like UK football scores and how to fish the best spots for smallmouth bass. Great stuff. Well, Lewis and so many of us always enjoyed our conversations and our relationships and times with Dave. For me, he was a source of optimism who listened carefully without judging my view, often easing my mind on many things. I think that's what a good friend does. I'm an only child, so I have illegally adopted two brothers, Chip Miller and Dave Nakdimen. And that's how I hold together my thoughts of my dear friend and brother, Dave.
Good afternoon. My name is Rich Jones. I'm a Presbyterian pastor serving in the UCC Church in Cincinnati, Ohio, and I grew up at the feet of Dave and Wanda. And actually, I have to say, I grew up Baptist, and being here in this service with all of you is a gift. You have an amazing church. Thank you. So growing up, I was always in awe of Wanda and Dave. Wanda and my mom were friends from their time at Georgetown College. They kept their friendship alive, and I have nothing but amazing memories of our families getting together a couple of times a year growing up, every year. I loved hearing Dave's stories whenever he came to our house or we went to their house. I also loved watching him on TV as he interviewed folks. I remember thinking, wow, this is wild. Here's Dave on TV and hanging out at the house. I would read up on the folks that he would interview. One of the things about Dave, not only was he a good storyteller, a good interviewer, but he was also a great listener. I always felt, even when I was a kid, that he was genuinely interested in what I had to say. He heard me. By the way, Wanda also has that same quality. She's incredibly perceptive and a great listener also. Together with Suzanne, they make a powerful family and still are. Dave's legacy lives on. I believe strongly what it says in scriptures, especially in Hebrews, that we are surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, past, present, future. We're all connected. And those witnesses not only cheer us on, but also help to mold us into being the people that we are. You know, there's an African proverb that our family has embraced, Ubuntu. It means I am because we are. And I know that I'm the person that I am today because of the love, the essence of the life of who Dave, Wanda, Suzanne are, and have been, and will be in my life. Dave's passing was in the midst of COVID, and it's so good to be here today. And as I said earlier, I know for me, and this has been a summer of reflection, and to be in this moment, to remember Dave and his faithfulness. And we may grieve in different ways, and I don't understand the mystery of death, but I do believe that death is not the final answer, that love does win. And someday, all of us will be with Dave again through the universal presence of Christ. And Dave's here now in this communion with us today. Friends, hear these words from Scripture. Ecclesiastes 3, 1 through 8. For everything there is a season and a time for every matter under heaven, a time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, and a time to pluck up what is planted, a time to kill, a time to heal, a time to break down, and a time to build up, a time to weep, a time to laugh, a time to mourn, and a time to dance, a time to throw away stones, and a time to gather stones together, a time to embrace, and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to seek, and a time to lose, a time to keep, and a time to throw away, a time to tear, and a time to sow, a time to keep silence, and a time to speak, a time to love, and a time to hate, a time for war, and a time for peace. And then Psalm 121, a psalm of ascents. I lift up my eyes to the hills. From where will my help come? My help comes from the Lord, who made heaven and earth. God will not let your foot be moved. God who keeps you will not slumber. God who keeps Israel will neither sleep nor slumber. The Lord is your keeper. The Lord is your shade at your right hand. The sun will not strike you by day, nor the moon by night. The Lord will keep you from all evil. He will keep your life. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time on and forevermore. God bless the reading of God's word.
As I begin to share reflections on Dave as an honor deacon, I invite our pallbearers to stand for a moment just to recognize those who were able to stand with the family on May 16th, 2020. Phil Collier, John Karam, Jim Hawkins, Jim McBee, Richard Hornbuckle, and Mark Golightly Sanders. Thank you. I had the great privilege on Sunday night to gather with some of Dave's pallbearers, and I invited them to share. Tell me about Dave, I said. And since then, I have been thinking a lot about the significance of honor deacons within the family of God at Highland Baptist Church, as Dave was one of our honor deacons. Our bylaws describe honor deacons as those who have shown exemplary leadership, service, and Christian maturity and wisdom over their tenure as a deacon. David Nakdimen served, I want to say at least six terms, based on records I have, at least six terms as a deacon at Highland Baptist Church from 1973 to 2004. The congregation elected Dave as an honor deacon in 2013. The deacon body, recognizing the need to commend models of admirable service, had pointed to Dave and said, this is the type of deacon that we want to imitate. For Dave Nakdimen was a deacon worth imitating, as I know you know. Through the vote on women's ordination and the disintegrating relationship with Southern Seminary, Dave led with faithful commitment to keep Christ's body whole here on this corner. His gift was one of gentle redirection, keeping the church moving forward without falling apart. He moderated meetings with grace, perfecting the art of a well-timed joke just when you needed it in an important meeting. And he could reinterpret your comment for what you really meant to say, shedding any of those minor jabs or divisive phrases you had thrown in. One cannot underestimate the power of honor deacons within the family of God. And let me be clear, I'm not speaking about perfection or purity or some absence of error. No, I'm speaking about the fact that we need examples in our lives to show us. Honor deacons give us tangible examples of what it means to serve. Because abstract ideas can only take us so far. To speak about gentleness is nothing like being in the presence of one who is gentle. Or perhaps better said this way, one cannot underestimate the power of how we feel when we're with an honor deacon. What it feels like to be around them is a hint of what it feels like to be with God. And it's not about a level of righteousness, it's about the way they are with us in love. So it's no surprise that everyone described to me the way Dave made you feel when you were with him. Dave was a gentleman, kind, humble, caring, warm, gentle in his strength, genuinely interested in others, patient even with the grumpiest in the crowd. It was a hug in the hallway or his laughter ringing through that hallway, funny stories from of serving alongside him to the church, the boisterous crowd whose holy connection was the University of Kentucky, with Dave sharing analysis with Bill Luster and Kenny Campbell and Eulen Rose and all the other Wildcat saints. His deep love for the Generations Bible Study class. And you knew that he was a big deal with an illustrious career in journalism. Even so, you saw that it was the same Dave in all the same places. To know him was to feel seen and to feel known. He listened when you told him stories, and he shared his own. To quote my dad, Dave was a curator of stories and a keeper of the flame. He made the ordinary compelling, and complicated church members became personalities worth celebrating in a good story. But it's not just that he had good stories to tell, although he did. And it's not just that he was a good storyteller, although he was. He stewarded his stories, sharing them with you until you felt like you had a shared sense of belonging in Highland's cloud of witnesses. What God had given Dave, Dave offered to you. So this sacred day, I invite you to wonder, who have you been able to be because of how Dave was with you? And who has this church been able to be because of how Dave was with this church right here? So thanks be to God, who knows that we need exemplary people who help us experience what it feels like to be with love made flesh. Amen. I share this morning with Wanda and Suzanne Dave's badge as an honor deacon, as a token of our gratitude for his service to Highland Baptist Church.
I'm going to lead us in a word of prayer, and at the end I'm going to ask you all to join me in praying the Lord's Prayer with me. So please pray with me. Holy and gracious God, thank you for your presence with us here today as we celebrate Dave. Whether we knew him as a journalist or a news commentator, a fellow deacon, a dear friend, an avid cat fan, or a cherished family member, we all loved him. And Lord, we are so grateful that we know that Dave loved you. And our faith assures us that you loved him. And even as we grieve that he's no longer with us, we know he now rests in your presence. Dave blessed each of our lives in so many ways, and we celebrate the man that he was, a gentle soul who loved you, loved life, and loved people. Be with us now as we pray together the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory. Amen. Amen.
Oh, Sharing a eulogy is a daunting task, as it's really difficult to capture and honor a person and their life in a few short paragraphs. And even highlighting some things about a person is sure to leave out some very precious moments in their history. When I think about Dave, I am reminded of the parable of the talents in Matthew 25. Dave used and invested the talents that were given to him by God, and he multiplied them with humility and kindness and gentleness and humor and, most of all, love. His life made such an impact on so many people. And so today, during the service, you've heard about his accomplishments, and you'll hear more about that soon, and his witness as a man of deep faith. But I wanted to be able to share some from the perspective of Wanda and Suzanne and Angela. So I sat down with Wanda recently at one of our breakfasts that we share and asked her to tell me about the Dave that she knew and what she loved about Dave. This is what she told me. Dave loved classical music. He loved the Louisville Orchestra. They used to go all the time. He loved community theater, and he had several important parts acting in plays. He loved getting together with his friends. He loved Western movies. You've heard about his John Wayne impersonation. He loved maple-flavored fudge. It was hard to find, but I did find it for him. Pelicans. He loved pelicans, Wanda told me. And he loved beach time at Fort Myers with dear friends. He loved to read and learn. And as Wanda said, he somehow always retained all that learning. He loved fall. UK sports, his dogs, and he loved his Wansie and Suze and Angela. He loved being with family, Betty and Gary and Kristen and Brian, all the crazy times they had at celebrations. I've heard some interesting stories about a pool party with costumes. And he loved gourmet meals in Michigan with his sister. Wanda shared with me that Dave's father was Jewish and escaped to the States from Warsaw, Poland as a young man. Dave's dad worked as a furrier to provide for the family. And when Dave was young, his family moved a lot and he was bullied for being the new kid at school often. He had a hard time. His family finally settled in London, Kentucky, and his parents owned a store called Fair. Is that right, Wanda? I never understood that name. You'll have to explain it. And Dave and his mom did all the buying for the store. Wanda met Dave at the wedding of his good friend, Roy Bowling, and Dave was the photographer. He was also in the service, Wanda said, and he and Wanda got to know each other during the activities of that weekend, that evening. And after the wedding, Dave sent Wanda a card asking if she was available for dinner. Wanda said no, she was dating someone else. Playing hard to get. But after a time, Dave found out that Wanda had broken up with this boyfriend, and so he tried again. Wanda was living in Lexington and working as a nurse at Central Baptist, and Dave would come and visit her on the weekends and take her out. This time, the connection between these two clicked, and they became engaged in August, and they were married on December 29th in about a foot of snow, as Wanda recalls. Now, if you know Wanda at all, you know she has kind of a sly sense of humor. You don't see it, but she has it. That showed up on her honeymoon when Wanda realized that Dave had taken off his wedding ring and left it on the sink in the bathroom. Wanda hid the ring from Dave and didn't tell him for a while. And poor Dave thought he was in big trouble. But Wanda finally confessed that she had hidden the ring, and I wonder if Dave ever took that ring off again. After the wedding, Dave moved to Louisville to join Wanda, who was there then, and started working at WAVE. Wanda worked at the hospital during the day, and Dave worked in the evenings. It was kind of a hard schedule. Wanda said that's why they got along so well, because they didn't see each other very much. But Wanda said she would come home after working all day, and Dave was gone, but Dave had hidden little messages and love notes somewhere in the house for her to find. Young love. They worked and developed their careers, and after they were married for several years, Suzanne came along, and Dave fell in love. He was attentive to her as a baby and a young girl, and he did a lot of things behind the scenes to help take care of her. Suzanne says her dad always came to her with a gentle approach. He'd ask questions and let her come to her own decisions. I guess you heard about the bathroom just a little bit ago. That's a new one, Suzanne. In high school, Suzanne had an interest in drawing, and she just would draw house plans for fun. And her dad noticed that, and he said maybe she would want to be an architect. So they sent away for a packet of information, what it would take to get a degree like that, what was involved in the career. And once Suzanne saw that, she said, nope, not for me. So Dave said, well, have you ever thought about interior design? Suzanne didn't know what that was, so Dave explained it to her. And good old Dave, he set up a meeting between Suzanne and Dottie Frank so she could ask, Suzanne could ask questions and get a better picture of what was involved. And Suzanne said Dottie became her life, her mentor for life. For college, Suzanne wanted to go to WKU. They had a design school and she had already gotten accepted. And she says, as always, Dave, in his quiet and encouraging way, encouraged her to, you know, go if that's what she wanted, move forward. But one day, Dave said to Suzanne, I've made an appointment for us to go tour the campus at UK. And he told Suzanne that if she went and she decided that it was not for her, that would be okay. But he wanted her to at least get on the campus, no pressure. So they went, walked across the campus, looked around, and soon Suzanne recognized that this is where she wanted to be. And by the end of the day, she was meeting with an advisor that Dave had set up. This was Dave's gentle, quiet way of parenting. Suzanne says he suggested things subtly and then allowed her to make the decision. When she made the wrong decision, he would say, no matter what, I will always be your dad, I will always love you, and you will always be my daughter. Whether big or little decisions, he stood behind her and beside her in his quiet way, and she always knew he had her back. I love this, what I'm going to tell you right now that Suzanne told me. She said, my dad was in front on the camera at work, but as my dad, he was always quietly standing behind me, letting me be at the front. And I think that's very true. One of the best gifts Suzanne ever gave her dad was being pop to his beloved Angela. He delighted in Angela as she grew, and they would watch movies together. And one of the crazy things that they did in this family, and Dave and Gary instigated this, was that whenever there was a birthday, and they celebrated them all together all the time, they would sing Happy Birthday, but Dave would start it, and they would all sing off key. So they recently had a birthday party where everyone was there, and they sang the birthday song off key. And after the chorus was over, Angela said, "I sure do, Miss Pop." We agree with you, Angela. We all miss Dave. He has left a beautiful legacy in our community because of his hard and honest work. He has touched the lives of many through his faith and his service to the church. He has created lasting memories with dear friends, and he will live forever in the hearts of family. Rest in peace, Dave, for you have multiplied your talents trusted to you. You have been a good and faithful servant. Amen.
The story of my relationship with my brother has five chapters. Chapter one was jealousy. Dave arrived when I was almost three. I remember that suddenly all of the adults in the family who had paid so much attention to me were gathered around a crib going ooh and ah over him. Chapter two was combat. As children, we fought frequently. I think we invented the food fight, and we even carried it on to the flatware. Chapter three was amnesty. Tiring of all the conflict, we finally called a truce. Chapter four, I will call understanding. Dave would draw bizarrely funny cartoons while I was drawing fashion designs. What had been disagreements and arguments finally turned into conversations. Chapter five, I'll call love, and it spanned approximately 70 years. During that time, most of the time, we were in different cities, so we did not see each other anywhere near as often as I would have liked. But the times we did have together, I much appreciated. Dave could always make me laugh. I admired his career accomplishments. I respected his integrity. And I most valued his compassionate and loving heart. I'm Judy Nakdimen, and that's my opinion.
As they say, how can you follow that? Wanda and Suzanne, I'm honored that you would have me say a few words. It might be a little more than a few. Dave Nakdimen lived for 31,220 days. Every day was filled with family, faith, and friends. An honored deacon in this church and devoted to its mission. Wanda and Suzanne were the center of his world. When Angela came along, Dave was ecstatic, the grandchild they so wanted. Dave was prouder than the NBC peacock. He and I had lunch two or three times a month for over 50 years, usually at Chex Bar. So I can tell you what he had, and I can tell you what he did not have. We know about the incredible career. He interviewed five presidents: Nixon, Reagan, Ford, H.W. Bush, and Clinton. Did interviews with nearly 80 congressmen, governors, and celebrities. Those included Bob Hope, Martin Luther King, John Wayne, and Jim, with all due respect, the correct line was, "Well, yes, say, Pilgrim," which is the way we always answered the phone. Charleston Heston, Roy Rogers, Billy Graham, and even the Lone Ranger. He knew more about the history of Kentucky politics than anyone. He won over 12 regional and national journalism and broadcast awards, inducted in the Kentucky Journalism Hall of Fame. Some things you may not know about Dave. He played the ukulele, drew cartoons for the UK student newspaper, one of his favorites, beat all the UK basketball players in ping pong. One of those players was John Brewer, who died last year, God rest his soul, and he confirmed all of that to me. Was on the UK billiard team that finished eighth in a national collegiate tournament. Worked for his hometown paper, the Sentinel Echo, in London, Kentucky. As we know, prior to Wave, he worked at the Old Herald Leader. Dave loved the arts, was a guest conductor of the Little Orchestra, acted in several stage plays at the Anchorage Theater, most notably The Music Man. What we forget about Dave is how physically strong he was early in his career. He had a handshake like a vice. Many of you know that. Typically, he would be at the courthouse and there would be 20 other reporters clamoring to get a story. What I called his profound boldness. He would be the first in and he'd be the first out with the interview. If there was a football game and somebody fumbled the ball, he would be the guy that came out of the pile with the ball. His peers had tremendous respect for him. Dave was all about humor and had a great wit. I recall one of his knacker features on Wave. And I hope this doesn't offend anybody, but this is what he was about. A casket company in Indiana was offering caskets with school colors and logos. You could get an IU, Purdue, U of K, or U of L. Are you a K casket? So here is Dave standing in front of one with a U of L logo on it. His line was, quote, "A U of K fan wouldn't be caught dead in one of these." Here is what Dave did not have, an ego. In spite of all his accolades, his humility was more important. In an industry full of egos, he was a true exception. He never wanted to talk about himself, what he was doing. People would come up and say something to him, At some point, I felt like I was his agent because he wouldn't talk about himself. He was a fixture in this community. Even after he was retired for years, people would recognize him with a comment, "Hey, Dave, I saw you on Wave the other night. You're doing a great job." Through his family and friends, Dave showed us how to live life. Through his faith, he showed us how to leave life. Amen, brother.
Our benediction today, you are invited outside on our front lawn for a reception. I know the family would love to visit with you there. At his retirement, Dave was asked in an interview with the Career Journal if he would do those 36 years over again. And Dave responded, "I think so. I really enjoyed it. It was a lot of work, but it was a lot of fun too." And I'm mindful that this is a pretty grand way to come to the end of one's life, that if you could do it all over again, for your answer to be a resounding yes. I think after today, we all know why. We have gathered today to grieve the loss of Dave Nakdimen, a curator of stories, as Phil Collier called him. And yet, even a year after his death, we have proclaimed that death will never have the final word of Dave's story. For I am convinced, as the Apostle Paul once wrote, that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And so thanks be to God for the beautiful life story that was David Nakdimen's. All thanks be to Jesus, who has welcomed Dave home into God's loving arms, whose arms are strong enough and tender enough to hold each of us today and in the days to come. The God who said, "Behold, I am with you always." With you, Wanda. With you, Suzanne. With you, Angela. With you, Judy. With all of you whom Dave loved so dearly, even to the very end of the age. Amen.